Please the court. Matthew Christian on behalf of Clark County and courtroom marshal Jim Keener. I'd like to reserve 2 minutes if I may.
Just watch the clock, counsel.
Will do. Thank you, Your Honor. This case is about the sanctity and dignity of courtroom proceedings. It's about maintaining order in a court of law. The specific question presented today is whether a courtroom marshal violates the Constitution when he uses minimal physical force to remove a person from a courtroom when that person has been acting contemptuously and when the judge has specifically ordered that person out of the courtroom. The district court decided that it is possible that the use of physical force, and in this case it was a mere shove, could violate the Constitution. We're asking for reversal because no matter how the court looks at this case, there simply is no constitutional violation. And even if there were, either absolute quasi-judicial immunity would apply, or at the very minimum, qualified immunity.
Now, at trial, you requested absolute immunity. That was your position.
That was the primary position.
And what's your position now?
Well, that is...
You'd be happy with qualified immunity, I'm sure.
We raised qualified immunity in the court below. Certainly the main focus was always on absolute quasi-judicial immunity. And then actually I thought I would start today with an argument that was not raised in the court below, but which this court can hear at its discretion, which was raised in the reply papers. And that's really, you know, which provision of the Constitution really even applies here. In the court below, there were so many claims. The focus, the assumption was always that it was the Fourth Amendment issue. As we raised in the reply brief, though, there really isn't a Fourth Amendment issue here because Mr. Brooks was never seized. Under the Fourth Amendment, there's no, it's not implicated unless there's a seizure. In this case, Mr. Brooks was shoved out of a courtroom. The law is very clear that only the 14th Amendment will apply in that situation. The substantive due process clause of the 14th Amendment.
It may be very clear to you, but it's not so clear. If it was so clear, you wouldn't be here.
I'm watching your time tick away. And so if we disagree with you about that, then what is your position on quasi-judicial immunity? Absolute.
Absolute immunity boils down to an interpretation of the case law. And the seminal case, the controlling case, is the United States Supreme Court case of Morales versus Waco. In that case, what had happened was a judge ordered a public defender, to come to his courtroom, ordered his marshal to go retrieve that person. The allegation is that the marshal used physical force, including the exact type of force that was used here, which was slamming the person through the double doors of the courtroom. The allegation there was that the judge had specifically ordered the marshal to use excessive force.
Right.
The district court dismissed the case based on absolute immunity, quasi-judicial immunity. This court reversed, and when it did so, this court made a distinction between the judge's order and the manner in which the order was carried out.
We recently referred that into Moots, right?
You did, and we cited the district court opinion in DeMuth, but I understand that it has been reviewed by this court.
So this is a whole lot. The typical default, we would start, wouldn't we, by looking at qualified immunity? That would be what we would expect in the law of this circuit, right?
Well, I think we could start with qualified immunity, but in the opinions, the courts also look at whether there's quasi-judicial absolute immunity, because the question is much simpler.
But isn't this exactly the case? Your position is that this individual was just following the judge's order, right?
Yes.
Okay, and isn't the question of degree about whether or not there was excessive force in the pushing or the shoving?
There's no question of, there could be questions of fact, but they're not material, they're not relevant, because what the Supreme Court said in Morales is that the act itself, in other words, the manner in which the order is carried out, the manner in which order is maintained in a courtroom, is not the relevant inquiry.
Are you familiar with the Myers case?
I'm not, Your Honor.
Well, it's another case where a officer was arresting someone, and a panel of this court decided that there was force used that was excessive, because after the person was handcuffed, one of the officers popped the guy on the head. So there was just no cause for that. He may have been, there's nothing wrong with the order, there was nothing wrong with carrying out the order, but he just sort of gratuitously popped him on the head. In this case, this is, as you say, just a matter of a shove, a push, and I don't mean to minimize that. If it were truly unnecessary, if the complaint had alleged that he was leaving the courtroom under his own steam, I guess there would be an argument that there wasn't a reason for any pushing or shoving. But that's not in the complaint here, and so I'm wondering why you're, wouldn't you be happy with a ruling that that qualified immunity attaches here? And it just seems to me to be a textbook case of that.
Well, certainly, Your Honor. I mean, we did raise qualified immunity below because there is no clearly established rule that required Mr. Keener to use any less force than a push.
Is there any implication that absolute versus qualified would have a different result for your client?
No. I mean, in our position below was that under either qualified immunity or absolute quasi-judicial immunity, the motion to dismiss should have been granted. We did spend most of our time on the issue of absolute quasi-judicial immunity because I think in general the level of force that's used is less likely to become an issue of fact if absolute immunity applies. And so that was where the main focus was. But certainly qualified immunity was very
counsel. You indicated you might want to reserve some time.
I do. I was going to reserve 2 minutes.
You're in charge of your own time.
Well, I still have 3 minutes left. I can rest now if the court does not have any further questions. And I reserve my time for rebuttal.
Very well.
Thank you.
May it please the court, Cal Potter, Las Vegas, Nevada, on behalf of Adam Brooks, Amberly. We're looking here at a straight application by the judge and the district court as not only the Graham factors, but White versus Roper factors in dealing with an excessive force claim, the minimization, even in the presentation here today by county counsel, deals with a mere shove. It wasn't a mere shove. We're confined by the truth of the pleadings, which the court found to be well-pled, that what had occurred here was that the individual, Mr. Brooks, was actually leaving, and he wasn't the individual that was involved in the other conduct that was before the court, that indeed what had occurred were two other individuals that were male enforcement agents that had come to perform their duties to reconcile the fact that these women had not met their obligations to the surety and had moved around and not stayed in contact when were in violation. Indeed, the court recognized that she had made a mistake even in placing those individuals into custody and being handcuffed under the statute 178.526, which allows bail enforcement agents who are licensed with the insurance commission to perform these types of duties if, in fact, the individuals have not agreed or abided by their conduct, which the public defender that was involved in this admitted. So what you have here,
what we have here, though, is the case of the marshal and the extent to which he may properly be accused of a constitutional violation.
Right, and the situation here is excessive force and the minimization that he was merely shoved through the closed doors of the courtroom isn't what was pled. He was forcefully shoved, required hospitalization and treatment after this occurred.
The question has to be whether his role as a marshal under the supervision of the judge has some form of immunity. And so let's hear your argument on that.
Well, the argument is that this is a Fourth Amendment violation. All the factors that are set forth in Roper, as well as Graham versus Connors, the civil case dealing with qualified immunity, are not met. There was no need for force to begin with. The judge asked him to leave. Our district court judge found that he was, in fact, leaving the premises. She relied upon the transcript of the proceeding. The judge in the justice court actually said, please escort this nice man out of the courtroom. reasons that we always look for in the use of force type situations. The bailiff decided to go hands-on as a punishment and retribution for what he perceived to be a disrespect for the court in his proceeding. The case that the court cited, the federal district court cited, Greg versus Anthony, dealing with well-settled law in 1974, tells us that indeed what occurs in these situations is that if a bailiff or a marshal uses excessive force, then that indeed would be a constitutional violation, although they're looking at a substitute due process. Demuth, which the court has also addressed, Judge Kaczynski talking about the fact that you can't go outside the scope of what the order is and look once again to the manner that was involved in the course of conduct. So this marshal decided that he was going to use excessive force. The individual is already leaving, and the court did not instruct him to physically do any of the things that are alleged in Merkley's or Case. So you have a situation here where there is a violent action on the part of the bailiff, no need to do it. Doesn't further the extent of the court's order. The extent of the injury was inflicted. She found that he had to go and get medical treatment.
Forgive me for interrupting, but you said that she made a finding that he was leaving on his own volition. Where is that, please?
The district court did that
Right. Where is that in the
transcript? Well, I'm not. It's in her transcript, I believe, at 41.
In the transcript as opposed to in the order.
Well, there is no written order. It's
Right. I'm looking at ER 43. I simply can't conclude at this early point in the litigation that the actions alleged here would be protected by qualified immunity, so I deny the motion to dismiss. I'm just looking for anything that, because the complaint does not allege that he was leaving on his own volition. So if there's a finding about to that effect, that would be very helpful to know.
41, line 15, escort this nice gentleman out of the courtroom. So there's no still questions here about what happened, the level of force that was used. I think that based on the allegations and the complaint of the forcible shoving and the need for hospitalization, that there's at least the plausible inference from these facts that the shoving was excessive, such that in carrying out the judge's instruction, Mr. Keener was not acting within the scope.
What about the case law that we have that says just a shove, a mere shove, is not sufficient?
But it's not a mere shove here.
The complaint alleges forceful shoving. That's your point.
And the fact that he received medical treatment.
Are you familiar with the Myers case?
No, I'm not, Your Honor.
Okay, thank you.
Unless you have other questions, I'll go ahead and submit it to this.
Thank you, counsel. Mr. Christian, you have some reserve time.
Yes, very briefly. Briefly, judges, it's very easy to say now when everybody is behaving in this courtroom that the need for force wasn't needed. That's exactly what qualified immunity is for. We're not to second guess those decisions as they're made at the time. I would direct the court's attention to ER 84. We need to remember that this particular bail bondsman was already the third bail bondsman who had appeared before Judge Lippis that day. She had already been forced to handcuff one of them because they were so disruptive. She had admonished that person for repeatedly interrupting her, arguing with her, interrupting other proceedings that they had no business in whatsoever. A second bail bondsman had come in, interrupted proceedings. She let him go because he left right away. He didn't cause too much of a controversy. Then Mr. Brooks was the third bondsman that had come into that courtroom that day, interrupting the proceedings. He told the judge
that bondsman number three in the transcript.
It is, Your Honor. The judge orders him out, out, out. She asks him, please leave. And as she's doing that, he continues to argue with her. He threatens to sue her. He's going to take names. He recites Nevada statutes regarding his supposed ability to arrest anybody whenever he wants.
What if he did all that and he admitted, she said, out, he started walking out the door? Would any force have been necessary?
I think under that situation, given the rest of the circumstances of that day, I think it is perfectly reasonable to expect a courtroom marshal to do whatever was necessary, whatever he felt was necessary, to make absolutely certain that this third person left.
Anyway, what I just indicated, that those aren't the facts pled in the complaint.
The facts pled are merely that he was shoved out the double doors. That's correct, Your Honor. So with that said, unless there are any further questions, I'll rest.
No further questions. Thank you, counsel. The case just arguably submitted for decision.
Thank you.
Your argument next in Barrientos versus Lynch.